Welcome everybody. So here we are. We are going to install Ubuntu 14.04, which is a derivative of Debian. And the operating system that I'm using is Windows 7 64-bit. It's i5 machine with 4 GB of RAM. So for Ubuntu operating system, in your desktop environment, you can use as much RAM as possible if you have the leverage for that. But we'll try to do it in 1 GB or 2 GB maybe. So the first thing that you need to do is what virtualized application you want to use. You can either use VirtualBox, that is free. It's an application by Oracle. Or you can also use VMware that I'm going to show you in this very video. In fact, I wanted to use VirtualBox over here, but VirtualBox on this Windows 7 architecture, it was getting installed properly and perfectly, but it was simply not opening up. So it's a good way to troubleshoot as well, that if you encounter the same problem, you can switch over to VMware Workstation Player. Now, first of all, you need to download this VMware Workstation application. So come on to the browser and go to the VMware Workstation website. Then click on Downloads. It's a free application, and these are the various platforms that are available by virtual machine VMware environment. We need to go to Workstation, and let's just bring it down. So bring it all the way down into the desktop and end user computing. And over here, you need to select this one, VMware Workstation Player. Click on Download. And just give it a while so that the page gets loaded up. And over here it says that what is the major release that you want to use and what's the minor release. I am already using 12.1, so this is the latest one. You can download this one. Just simply click on download, and once the download gets started, you can save it wherever you want to. Likewise, if you come on to VirtualBox website, which is virtualbox.org, and from here you can click on downloads. Just give it a second, and from here you can select for your Windows environment, since I'm assuming that you are using Linux environment for the first time, so your base operating system would be Windows. That's my presumption. So you can select x86 architecture, or it supports 64-bit as well. Same file is used for both types of installations of operating system. Once you get this downloaded, install it and run it. And I'll show you that how we can create a virtual machine in VirtualBox as well. It's the same thing as we'll be doing in at the moment for VMware environment. The third thing that you need to do is, once you get the VMware workstation downloaded, the file that is over here, you also need to have the Ubuntu distribution. You can download the latest one, which is 15.10, I believe at the moment. It's a derivative of Debian and maintained by and contributed by the community. It's a very good operating system. I've been using it for quite some years now, and I'm quite comfortable with it. So to download Ubuntu 14.04, you need to come on to the download tab, and from here select the desktop environment. Once it gets opened up, just give it a while. So here we are. This is the page that you need to go to. You need to select Ubuntu, or you can even select 15.10. This 14.04, this is LTS, or long term support. It's released. The patches for this version will be supported for up to 5 years. So if you download it now, it will be good enough for till 2019. You can select 64-bit, or you can select 32-bit. If you have got, already saying that for machine less than 2 GB, but it's not necessary. If you have got like 4 or 6 GB RAM, you can still use 32-bit. But we are going to go with 64-bit. It's more or less the same. If your architecture supports 64-bit, I would recommend that to go for it. Then afterwards, simply click on download and just give it a while. If you want to make a donation, which I would urge that you do if you have the pocket for that. Otherwise, you can come over here and select not now, take me to a download. Now once you click that, we will have a dialog pop up for the download of the particular file, which is over here. You can simply save it, and once it gets saved, you can mount it in the virtual machine, which we are going to do right now. So once your file gets downloaded, you will get something like this, which is an ISO file. Now let's come on to the installation process of VMware. It's a simple application, VMware Player, that we had downloaded earlier. You simply need to double click it and run it through. Let's give it a moment. And from here, click on next and go on. I have already installed it, so it's asking me to change it. I do not need to change it, but over here, once you start downloading it, it will say that download, you simply need to click next, a couple of next, and you will be all done. So once that is finished, you will get an icon like that. It's a shortcut. You can open it. And here's the default screen of VMware that you will get. Once you get a machine created, it will show up over here in this space area. At the moment, there is none. So now let's try to create one. Click on the create new virtual machine. We are going to create Ubuntu virtual machine in our Windows environment. And the application that we are going to use for this virtualization is VMware. So click on create a new virtual machine. From here, you can select either install disk or install disk image file, like the one that you can even see that I had tried to use it. But if you select this option, it starts the installation process right away, which I do not want to do. I want to show you that what are the steps that you need to go through. And even if you are doing it on a physical separate machine, on a physical server or desktop, you need to choose your options carefully, what partitions you need to make, how much space or the disk space that you need to allocate for that particular partition, what the size is, what's the type of that partition. If you select above 2, it does not give you that option. Straight away takes you to the installation and you cannot even choose the option. So first create this one, a virtual machine, and then we will mount the ISO image in it and run the machine from there. So I click on next. From here, it will create a generic type of machine based on the parameters that we are giving in at the moment. So the guest operating system, we are making this VMware a wise guess that the operating system will be of Linux type, and it would be of 64-bit architecture, Ubuntu based. Now that's the location for the virtual machine. You can name it anything. Let's just go by the default. Click on next, and over here it is saying that what is the maximum disk size. This image where all the Ubuntu operating system will be placed in a shape of a file. I would recommend that for you, if you have got a healthy disk like maybe 1 terabyte or maybe 500 GB or 250 GB or even less than that, I would say that you should go with at least 50 GB, so that once you get this system installed and you start playing with it, you install multiple programs in it, then you do not get short of the space. So at least 50 GB should be here. Since I know that I would not be needing that much, so I'm going to go with 6 GB. And over here, there are two options, that you can create one large file or you can create multiple files. Let's go with a single file option at the moment. This is only required if your files are getting way much lengthier and you want to split them up so that it would be easier for you to move the image files from one location to another. So let's go with one single file. Click on next, and these are the parameters that is showing us at the moment. Let's just click finish. We can change certain parameters by selecting customize hardware, but we'll do that later. So I click on finish. And once that gets finished, we have this template of the virtual machine that we have just created. Now we click on the settings of this virtual machine, and from here we select the CD or DVD image, and over here we mount the image of the Ubuntu ISO file that we had just downloaded. From here I click on browse, and I go to that particular location where my image is placed, which is over here. I click on open, and once that gets opened up, we can see that the file has been placed over here. Also, regarding this, let me just come over here. Memory, at the moment I'm giving it 1 GB. I believe it is enough for making of this video, but for you, I would recommend if you got more RAM, if you got like 8 GB or 16 GB in your machine, you can easily give it 4 GB or even 2 GB, it should be fine. But I would recommend for 8 GB host operating system, you can leverage up to 50% of that for your guest operating system. So let's leave it 1. Processors, as many processors you want to give it, I'm giving it 1. I can give it 2 as well, it's all right, or how many you want. I would recommend that for Ubuntu operating system, 2 processors are good enough. Then the disk space that we had set earlier, over here we have this NAT option. Now regarding this network adapter options, the default is NAT, and it means that the guest operating system will use an IP address that will be allocated by your host operating system, which in this case is Windows, but that will not be visible to your other LAN environment. So your other LAN machines, if they are connected with your host machine, which is over here, like in this case, this Windows 7, your LAN machines will be able to communicate with your host machine, but not with the guest machines. But guest machines, they will be able to communicate, or they will be able to see your LAN machine. So it's like one-way communication. It's just like you can go to the internet while you are sitting behind the modem, your DSL or cable modem, but internet machines cannot see your individual PCs or laptops. So that is a good option. The other option is host only. This means that your guest operating system will only be able to communicate with the host operating system and not the other LAN machines or not even the internet. The third option is bridged one. This means that your guest operating system will use the physical interface card, or your, if you got wireless, of your host operating system, and it will be able to go out on the internet using the same very IP addressing scheme that your host operating system is using. So if your host operating system is getting an IP address through a DHCP server and you select bridge option for your guest operating system, then your guest operating system will also get an IP address from your DHCP server. So since we want this machine to be able to access the internet, I am selecting this bridge option over here. And if you click on configure adapters, that what are the physical adapters that need to be bridged for this guest machine, you click on configure adapters, and over here I have this loopback adapter configured, I have this virtual Wi-Fi mini port, I have this gigabit ethernet as well, and this Wi-Fi. I want this Wi-Fi to be bridged for this guest machine. So I selected it and I click on OK. And the other options are USB controller. If your guest operating system should be able to access the USB interfaces, sound card, let it be on default. And for same is true for printer and display. You can also add other hardware if you want to by clicking on add. And from here, whatever hardware you want to add for this particular guest machine. Now, one option I can show you is if you click on options, and from here you can change these settings if you want to, but this is the important one that I wanted to show you, that shared folders disabled. Now what this really option really does is that you share a folder on your host operating system and your guest operating system will be able to access that as well. So it will be easier for sharing the files. If you put a file in shared folder in your host operating system, like in this case, this is Windows 7 machine, and you enable your shared folders over here by always enabled and giving the path that whatever shared folder you want to give, then that shared folder will be accessible in your guest machine as well. But for Linux distribution, it's a bit tricky and it takes compiling the kernel. So I would say that at the moment, since you might not be aware of that and you are new to Linux, I presume, I would say that stay away from that, at least at the moment. And for purposes of transfer of files, I would say that you can simply use FTP server. That I'll show you that how you can do that. But this is a very good option. In fact, if you are using, let's say you are trying to virtualize a Windows machine on either a Linux machine or a Windows machine. Let's say if you are trying to virtualize a Windows XP machine on this Windows 7 host machine, then this option is pretty easy. You simply need to enable it over here, and you need to enable for VM workstation, you need to enable its tools, and all will be good. Likewise, the same goes for VirtualBox installation as well. Over there, you need to install the gear editions that we'll see later. So I just click on OK, and after that, let me just check if we have given the path. I believe that okay, ISO file is selected. So now let's just shoot up the virtual machine. Let's power it up and give it a while it's powering on. So this is the screen that we are represented with. It's time for a while. It is taking a bit longer. It is starting the boot process, and we are seeing this Ubuntu screen coming up, where it will ask us about the installation process.